This channel is not intended for children. Please kickstart responsibly.
Hey everybody, I'm back, and it is another big grouping of campaigns in February. I did a little mini episode for the Zine Quest thing. It was the last episode. I'll link it to at the end. And if you're looking for crazy RPG stuff, that's the place to jump into. Now we're going to get into the other types of RPG stuff. This first one is the Folio, and it is a quarterly magazine that has been created for the last 5 years, and it is all about this particular world that is for Dungeons & Dragons 5e, 1-4 players. If you're already jumping in on it, you're in the DM's Guild or whatever, lots of people have previously enjoyed Scott Taylor's works. He has 56 created campaigns so far, so quite a bit of stuff. If you're looking for something specifically to 5e and not part of Zine Quest, which is all about creating brand new little tiny worlds that can be expanded on, then this is a good place to get started. And speaking of getting started, if that's something you're having trouble with, that's what Random Results is all about. It is 500 ideas plus of ways to just get started. Story hooks, different ideas, encounters, whatever it is that you want to do. If you can't think of a reason to play, but you do want to play, then that's what this book is all about. You can just jump in and do something new. Maybe you've used up all your books. You don't want to spend $50 on a new, brand new campaign, so you just want to play a little adventure. Maybe you want to play a bunch of little adventures. Random Results is there for you to jump in on. Then if you want something different, this is Chancellorsville. This is a war game that has a little bit different mechanic I haven't seen before. Maybe if the people that spend most of their time playing these war games will chime in as to if this is something that they use a lot. But if you can see in the upper right there, there's these screens, and I think that's to act as like a fog of war to keep your formations hidden. So that seems pretty neat. You're not really knowing what's going on, depending on the weather, depending on how far troops are away. If you're using long-range stuff, then as far as your weaponry, artillery or whatever, unless you have a telescope or, you know what I mean, like something along that line to increase your vision, it's going to be difficult to see what the other troops have going on. It's an interesting mechanic. Civil War of the United States, right there, smack dab in the middle. And if this intrigues you, let me know. Also, just keep in mind, you guys can jump ahead. If you go to the descriptions, you can go to the Kickstarter links themselves. Just click on description. Or if you want to jump ahead to other campaigns in case one of these isn't something that you like, you can click on the links for the time indices and it'll take you further ahead. And speaking of jumping into the future, Planet 28 is a sci-fi game for Skirmish fans. And you can use whatever minis that you want. It's just paper and dice right now. But you can use whatever of the many, many, many sci-fi or Warhammer 40K or whatever types of minis you've been using before to play out these rules. It's just something that's a little bit different. If you aren't currently satisfied with the sci-fi game you have, or maybe you just want to try something that's a little bit different, it's just a little tiny rule set that's supposed to play fairly quickly for miniature warbands. So not giant armies, just, you know, a couple of units, then this may be something that is of interest to you. So we're going to try on something different. Mythic Games, which is known for putting out big miniatures games, is now distributing this Enchanters East Quest game. It's part of their Phoenix line instead of their regular Mythic line that they develop in-house. This was something that they found as a game, and they thought more people should play it, so they got the distribution rights, and they're putting it out under their banner, but under the Phoenix product line to let people know about the potential of it. Looks Chinese to me with the Monkey King, and it's a 1-4 player card game that you do card drafting to make combos out of different artifacts. So if you needed a card game, and you trust Mythic, then I'd say take a quick look at it, especially if you like the cartoony aesthetic of, I mean, there's a Medusa there, so I don't want to say it's just Chinese, and there's maybe a Dryad, so some type of ancient lore Mythic card game. Then we have a different type of card game. This is Gray Eminence, about politics. And it has some weird functions. Like, it says it has a tweet deck in it, and it has a blue bird. But I don't think that it is actually licensed by Twitter to have that on there. You pick a bunch of different folks, such as Green Greta, Deep Throat, Queenie, all these other folks that look like they're inspired by people that are in the news right now. I don't know how long that's going to last, but I would say they didn't do anything that is too weird that it wouldn't, even if you didn't get the joke, you'd probably be okay. But otherwise, you use just regular funny-looking meeples. Some of them have Illuminati symbols, or they have skull and bones, and that group that runs out in the woods of California and burns an owl, and Rosicrucians, and even some Freemason type things right there in their symbology. So all these different factions running around trying to play political games, and you have secret objectives for each player, and you know, you're trying not to let your secret objective be known because it's a secret, but at the same time push forward an agenda that hides things. If you're into politics and secret conspiracies, this may be a fun game for you. Then we have a hex-based game of clan warfare that is looking for another round of funding. This is the YOHEI relaunch, and as you can see there from the board, it's got hexes. It's got pretty good art from what's going on in there. It has fully funded at this point. I don't know why they pulled it from before, but if you're looking for something in an Asian theme, a fantasy Asian theme with asymmetric warfare, YOHEI may be something that interests you. Other games that are similar to it, I can't really think of the names off the top of my head, but we've seen a bunch that look very, very similar. You know, so maybe that might be why it didn't fund the first time, and now it just happened to find the space it needed to get the people that want it into their hands. Then, as I'm recording this right now, this is the hottest game on Board Game Geek. This is the Kanban EV edition. This is about making cars, specifically electric vehicles. Kanban as a game has been mentioned many times as a recommendation from folks in the Facebook groups I'm in. They seem to enjoy it quite a bit. The meeples all look pretty cool. They look like the type of cars that are coming out now. Kanban, what it actually means is the system for production that they use in Japanese car manufacturing, as opposed to the Henry Ford method. It's probably worker placement management. I have yet to play the game, but if it is super popular like it is, it's popular for a reason, because people don't play games that they don't enjoy. So take a quick look at it. If you haven't played it yet, or maybe you've heard of it, this might be a good time to jump on. And we can't talk about gaming without some dice. If you need Leviathan dice, they have little Kraken-looking dudes as far as their high numbers, and some of them glow in the dark. They've got glitter effects and other stuff on them as well. I like the high contrast because you can see the numbers, something that so many dice manufacturers forget is a requirement of the function of the dice themselves. And I don't know how often you're going to be rolling in the dark, but if you are a lot, then it might be a good suggestion to also take a, maybe a white pen or something white out, or some handy dust from like a day glow color, and fill those numbers in if you're rolling it in the dark. Otherwise, maybe you just have it there to, impress people with your UV paint jobs like I do half the time. Then we have a game called Battlebetes, which is about diabetes. And one of the things that it has that I don't see in many other games, they fully 3D printed all of these extra tokens themselves. Like, they have a whole wall of Prusa I3s that they sit there and try to knock out. All these little two-tone custom pieces that they probably would not be able to make if they did it through injection molding. They'd have to use paint. So more power to them for that. I'm not sure how many people need to be reminded about diabetes. Maybe if it's somebody who is trying to explain to their class, or you're trying to explain it to a kid that it's not, you know, the worst thing in the world, or what type of life choices you need to make depending on the type of diabetes you have. Maybe any of those things, or they just wanted to educate people on diabetes not being, you know, something to make fun of people. South Park's got a diabetes character, right? So maybe it's just inspired by that. I don't have diabetes, so I can't tell you if it's offensive or not, but the components are all pretty cool. I'll give them that. Then if you're looking for something to personalize your gaming experience, these are new playmats. They come in a variety of different types, and they're unlocking more with big creatures on them. They use Magic the Gathering there, but I'm sure you can use it with just about any card game that you want. If it helps bring some theme, or you could do like the old warriors used to do when they'd put big crazy designs on their shields to scare their enemies. Maybe that's why you have, you know, a zombie horde or a big dragon, if that's the theme of your deck, and you just want to scare your opponents by having, you know, some nice, scary, full artwork playmat available to you. That's up to you. I say you should have as much immersion as possible and enjoy your gaming as much as possible. And if this will help you, click on the link in the description and give them some money, and you'll get yourself a playmat. Or three, or five, or six, however many you want. Then we have a game from Italy that's supposed to be about the 1950s United States and the production of jam. So it is a Euro game. You obviously have farmer meeples, as you can see down there. You got your jars, you get your different fruits, and you have to make decisions as to how you're going to run your canning operation. If this sounds neat to you and you want to jump in on it, Frutticola by geochicks.it. And if you haven't tried your own type of canning as far as preserves, I'm going to make you a quick suggestion on Meyer lemon and blueberry, and you can thank me later. Then we have a game called King Arthur's Vortex Chess, but it's not played on a chessboard or with chess pieces or have the rules of chess or have anything to do with chess. Therefore, it is just confusing. They could have picked a different name. You do line up with both sides. You do have two sets of opposing factions, so for a two-player game, but that's kind of where the chess part ends. You run at each other, and you have various Arthurian themed standee powers, as you can see, as you run at each other. So I don't like the name, but maybe the game is fun. If you like games with standees instead of minis, you might be able to use other types of fantasy type minis in order to fill out the rest of the game. If that's not your thing, then this may also be a fun game for you. Take a look at the rules. Ignore the video. It tells you nothing. And then, you know, just jump down and look at it and see if this will scratch your itch for Camelot, which I hope is not syphilis, because I'm sure they had syphilis back then. And I don't make it a secret that I'm from the United States of America, and one of our national treasures is our national park system set up by Teddy Roosevelt, because he just loved nature that much. And in order to encourage folks to go out there and see what's in those national parks, these folks at Keymaster Games last year came out with a game called Parks, where you go around and it's a matching game, and you're encouraged to look at different features that you'd find in all these different national parks. Well, they had such success that they decided to change up the timing and make Nightfall, so you have more park cards, but this time about features that you might find at night, and a unique set called Memories that has more cool stuff in it, and you know, different, it's got this hiker, it's got different abilities, it's got all this other cool stuff. Also, meeples. If you're into collecting meeples, they got a little animal ones. You can use them in other games, Wingspan, whatever. And yeah, lots of different options. Things that you can just play a nice, calm game that maybe will encourage you to have a nice vacation with the kids later in the year. Nothing bad about that. There's nothing bad about these dice sleeves. These are engraved pieces of wood that you can keep your dice in. And I'm all for customizing your gaming experience to make it more connected to you. They have ravens, they've got skulls, they've got little fractal designs that look like lightning bolts. They have laser-cut dice that you can get with different examples on them. I like the bone one personally. The stone one looks kind of neat too. Depends on whatever it is that you're looking for. It's nice to have a good piece of personalized gear. You can get it in whatever type of wood you want. They have a bunch of different options. If you click on the link in the description and jump to their site, you'll be able to see all the options and pick one up if that works for you. Then if you think your fantasy world is not full enough of little critters, that's what Niwri's Marvelous Menagerie of the Multiverse is all about. Instead of just having monsters that you can defeat, this is like the sugar glider that you see there in the middle. So you have like a magical sugar glider. It also has maps for various ships and other things that you could be utilizing. They are specifically airships. The idea being that you're flying around in these airships and basically being a Pokemon Ranger. If that's not what you want to do, but otherwise you want to be a ranger that does, or druid that has some specific animals in their groves, then this may further expand out the world for you and make it more interesting. Then if you want to further expand out your table with terrain, this is what the Wardroid Graveyard has in it. They have the nicely painted, it's like a hand of a titan. I'm not sure what's going on there. That they build the rest of the scenery out of. Then they have all these other little pieces as if it was a crumbled and destroyed, I guess, Iron Giant, maybe? Whatever world previous folks had existed there. I mean, even in a fantasy setting, it's okay because this could be something that some magic artificer had created tens of thousands of years ago, and this is the remains of whatever Colossus. I mean, we even had the Colossus of Rhodes in a regular world that the pieces of, you know, would be utilized in the same capacity after it fell. So you can 3D print all this stuff, break out your resin printer, and it'll all look pretty. There's a lot of detail going on, so I'd say resin's probably the best way to go, especially if you got a nice large build plate that I've been seeing on a lot of these new ones. Then we have a different 1-4 player deck building post-apocalyptic fantasy survival game, Aeon's End Outcasts. This doesn't have anything to do with Aeon's Trespass Odyssey, even though they have very similar names, nothing to do with each other. If you're into card games and you're looking for a different one, as you can see, the artwork looks pretty cool. You just have to see if the game itself is something that you would enjoy. I don't know how best to describe it, but there are expansions to go along with it. And you can just jump into this Aeon's End world. I do know how to describe terrain, though, and this is the Atomic Shelter. This is an underground complex. You can stack them up however you want. This is basically running through a Fallout vault built for a very small number of people. If you wanted to print these off yourself and to make them bigger, you can. But basically, this is just designed to resist an atom bomb. And that's a great dungeon. And if you just want to paint it up, or maybe you just wanted to make a little diorama of a post-apocalyptic world, that'll work great too. Or maybe even Half-Life. Lots of different options available with all the stuff that they're providing. Man, I kind of feel bad for this dude. He made Big Bad Fables just to get his wife to play a game with him. Because otherwise, she's no fun. And then he make a whole 2-minute video about it. If the art intrigues you, then go ahead and jump in on it. Otherwise, this may be a little too cute for the comparison of a lot of these games. I would save it for the kids. It's an introductory deck building game. It's not for anyone to have anything super complex. I don't know what that says about the dude's wife, but, you know, more power to Mr. Raymond Sarah, and good luck with your wedded bliss. When it says happily ever after, I'm like, did they die? Really? You want to throw that in there? I don't know. But it's based on all the stuff you would see in Mother Goose Fables. So you've got Big Bad Wolf, Three Little Pigs, Dormice, all that kind of fun stuff, Mama Bear, Papa Bear, Goldilocks, all that jazz. So if you're familiar with those Mother Goose things and you're looking for more in your life to be able to share that with somebody, jump on in. I'll still make fun of you. It doesn't matter who you are. Then we have more of a game that you should have made her play because it's based on 80s sci-fi, and there was no better decade for sci-fi than the 80s. Fractured Galaxy. This has some simple meeples. They're based on ships. They do different things. But some of the things that you can do in this game is it's a 4X game. You explore extinction, all that, you know, 4Xs. But it has a solo mode and a full campaign for being such a simple bit of components. Still pack in a lot of interesting game stuff in there. I've seen a lot cooler looking components, but that doesn't include the solo mode, and it doesn't include the full campaign. Otherwise, it's just like a 1v1 or one person versus another space game. So a couple of the options that they provide, including free shipping, you know, hey, gotta love that. And they just make this a compelling option. Take a look at the gameplay, see if it's something that you would enjoy. If you want something that's space-driven, that doesn't have all the fancy bits in it, but keeps the cost down, this could be your first space combat game, or just something you can play on your own on your lunch break because of that, like I said, it has that campaign with the solo mode. And speaking of a different type of 80s nostalgia, that is the Fury of Gozmar. And I would click on that video if I were you. It looks like one of those old toy commercials we used to watch in the 80s. And I say we because I've seen the demographics. You were there. I know you were there. Anyway, it's a fantasy-driven game for two players. But you're trying to somehow get this goblin Gozmar to jump on your side by bribing him. I like the mechanic. Otherwise, it's got tiles and other cool stuff you could use if you wanted in other hex-based games. That part's up to you. You could also use the minis for other types of fantasy play. So for just having a simple two-person game, if you didn't have time for a regular big old RPG campaign, or you just wanted to bring someone in who was a little bit younger to understand what's going on in fantasy stuff and fight some goblins, Fury of Gozmar, baby, for you. The video is definitely for me. I laughed. Then we have something based on Gregor Mendel and his experiments with pea plants, where they discovered the concept of phenotype and genotype. If you want to teach genetics in a very simple way, then this is a good option. They have an upgrade also for a collector's edition that has, as you can see, the little houses and metal stuff, which is kind of neat. It is otherwise a worker placement and dice drafting game, so if you were already familiar with that type of play, you can play it solo, and that is neat too. I'm sure it is great for everyone but the creationist in your family, so that's the only consideration I'd make. They might get a little offended at the concept of being able to crossbreed species. Then if you had bought Arena the Contest before, maybe I think it was last year or the year before, it was a medium-sized project. It was doing pretty good. Then you might want to jump on the 1.5 version, which also comes with Tanares Adventures. One of the other things to note is they have a lot of minis, and they do look really cool. They've been reworked, and it is now in a Legendary Dragon collection that are fairly awesome. I'm going to just throw it out there. If you look at the main page, you'll see the first thing that pops up on the video is this cool looking skeletal dragon figure. Is way better than what Simon put out for Green Horde. It is really nice. It just didn't have anything for me to put up easily for you guys to look at here, but you can see the big layout, a collection of things that are there on the board. Like I said, Arena was a medium size. This is a good time to jump on if you wanted it before, or you could utilize the minis for other things. I read about this game in the Kingdom Death forums. People were talking about how excited they were about the minis for this while they were waiting on Kingdom Death, and I know a lot of you guys are also waiting on Kingdom Death, so maybe this is an option to jump in with them. Then we have a couple games that fit in a mint tin, and this is Tinderblox and Kittin. Both of them are stacking. The tinder blocks, I think, is supposed to be you're making a fire, and you know, the how you put the box or blocks together is a symbolic version of how well your fire is created. That part's fine. Kittens, I think this is just kitten Tetris, but they just can't say that that's what it is. Both require at least two players, so if you're going to play it on your break, then you're going to have someone to play with. But maybe play with kids, because it is a fast setup thing that says ages 6 and up, and there are not that many games that are good for 6 and up. I would just beware, if you do have those young children, though, it fits in a mint tin, make sure they don't put it in their mouth. Make sure they don't swallow it. You know, just be cautious. Be attentive. Then we have a new product from Nord Games. This is the ultimate guide to alchemy, crafting, and enchanting. They have a bunch of other products that includes separate versions for alchemy, crafting, and enchanting different things. They've combined them here. Artwork looks pretty cool. It fits within the world. And like I said, they have many other products that are available on the DM Guild for 5e. So you can see what type of product you'll be getting if you click on their page or you look up their other stuff in the DM Guild or other places, and you can see the quality and see if it will work for you. All different types of crafts and armor and potions and poisons and other runes and other abilities you can put into armors and weapons and make them do all kinds of fun things that will personalize the character even more and tell more of the story that you're looking to tell. Then we have the City of Gold Adul, and it is for 5e. You could probably use it for a bunch of other stuff as well. Just have to do slight modifications. And it is about exploring level 6 to 8. This new city, it's out in the wastes and has other cool stuff in it. I would suggest having Temple of Annihilation because it has anthropologist and archaeologist as possible character backgrounds that may be helpful in this type of situation. And if you've already gone through Temple of Annihilation, which can take you from level 1, it'll get you up to this range 6 to 8. And then you can jump in and already have someone who's used to spelunking and going through you know, the weird stuff that you find in these various dark ruined places. And this is a campaign about choices, but it doesn't have anything to do with elections. It is Choose CTHULHU, and it is a choose your own adventure based in the Lovecraft world. So all the different Lovecraft stories, basically you are running through and making choices playing as the protagonists of the original Lovecraft stories. From what I can tell, that's what's going on. That's awesome, because a lot of the Choose Your Own Adventure stuff, the Choose Your Own Adventure games, the board games, so far have been terrible. I need something that has a little more meat to it, a little more stakes, a little more terror, a little more giant squid god. Why not jump in with me? You can pick up a bunch of different books. They've got a lot of big selection. And keep the Lovecraft fun going. Then we have one of these political games, Trump Roast. I don't know if it's for the people on the left or on the right. I try to avoid as many of these as I can. I just throw them in for the sake of completion, because typically I feel like these politically involved games are of the moment and nothing else, and will age as well as a fart in the wind. And I've said that many times in many different ways. This one specifically is about using the exact words of the current U.S. president in various stages to defend or to fight against proposals that occur. Because it's just using the words that are in there, I don't know if it's... I mean, it's definitely satirical, but I don't know which side it's supposed to be for or how it will work in various company. I think this one might actually work fairly well in mixed company, but as agitated and everything as people are, and you know, just I've been feeling like crap all week because of everything that's going on. You just feel like there's no good people left, you know what I mean? Especially the ones that you're paying to have good judgment. They just don't. Then I don't want to be reminded of this in 4 years or 2 years or 3 days even, of what's been going on. So if you got to be very careful, and you know, don't bring it in if you're not sure that you're going to have fun with your group. Then we have a new campaign from Fraser Ronald, who seems to have a lot of fascination for the world of 3,000 years ago. And this one is about the last Bronze Age catastrophe, downfall of civilization. And, you know, it's nothing. He did a lot of stuff for Greeks. He did a lot of stuff from his other books with centurions and other types of peoples, also in the Asian worlds. This one, I believe, is specifically in the Greek world. The triremes that you see and the batagrams and all that, I believe, are Greek and haven't switched quite over to Roman. But the Bronze Age was a fascinating time, was a deadly time. And, yeah, if the world was falling apart at that time, then, you know, it's a wealth of stories available, lots of room for heroes to grow and jump in on. And maybe you'll learn something. Then we have the campaign I'm most happy to back, and this is finally a solo-capable minis game for Vampire the Masquerade. This one's called Chapters. It's made by Flyhouse Games. They've made a couple of other games before. And as you can see, the minis are going to look good, at least from the renders that they put out. They've got a lot of high detail. The way that the game plays out is you can be one of any of the regular eight clans, and there's one clanless one. If you aren't happy with the selections, then you can just be one of the clanless types and build whatever type of vampire you want to be, which is all cool. I hope this works out really well. There are lots and lots and lots of options on each one of the stories that come out, so you can play the characters however it is that you want. Obviously, if you have a more physical character, if you have one that uses more hypnosis or some type of other treacheries, then you're going to have different options available to you. Some things will be harder than others, and you get to use your blood supplies in various ways. So it's a bit like a choose-your-own-adventure, but you do still have some types of roles for combat and other things that can change the way that the game plays out. Lots of story, lots of different scenarios being added as stretch goals all the time. And even fairly reasonably priced painted minis as another option. Then we have a game called Culture Tags, which uses the... I don't know how this works. I guess people condense all of the things that they want to say down to the first letter of the sentence and then pop them all in and then have the punctuation at the end. You're allowed to give hints as to whatever it is, but you're otherwise not able to say what it means. I don't know if I'd be very good at this. I have no idea what they're trying to come up with. There's a dry erase board. Maybe you can like make a Pictionary style, help them guess at it. Yeah, I mean, Pictionary is a guessing game. Maybe this is just like a word version of that. It might be fun. It just depends on the group you're with. I would not know any of these if they're actual hashtags that people use all the time. Maybe that would give an unfair advantage to the person who spends all their time on their phone. Then we have a game that is a new type of RPG, but it is designed to be used by people in a classroom, as it tells a story from the time of 1500 to 1650 in Brazil. So if this is part of your social studies world, then you might be able to have this as a an interesting... there's no sea monsters in real life, so I'm not sure how that part works for the classroom type, but maybe it's something for an after-school program would be a little bit better. But like I said, there very well could be some political situations that are expressed in here that you could use as part of social studies. It's up to you, called Elephant Macaw Banner, the role-playing game. And if it is made specifically to be used in a classroom, I can see why it might need modified rules that wouldn't necessarily just work in Dungeons & Dragons or one of the other more popular systems. Art looks neat. It's not perfect, but it looks neat. And I would like to see how a classroom actually interacts with this and if the kids actually get anything out of it, education-wise. Then we have a neat parlor game, and this is an old-school parlor game, and I don't know what the original one was called, but you set up these coasters, and someone is going to be the killer. And if you are the killer, you're supposed to go over and make eye contact with various party guests and wink at them. Once you wink at them, they are supposed to wait 10 seconds and then die in the most dramatic way possible to make it fun for everybody. And eventually someone has to figure out that you're the one killing everybody off. You have to get caught. So it seems neat. Not really much to do after you've been eliminated. You know, it could be very dramatic and fun the way that you die. And you can hopefully not spill red wine all over the carpet, whatever the thing is, but do something interesting and fun and get that inner performer out. And the last game we were able to fit in is Tramways, Adelaide, and Shanghai. This is all about public transportation and creating a tram system that does its best in these various cities. Obviously, it's not to scale, but that doesn't make it any less interesting. They're just brand new maps for you to construct your best method of moving people around these cities. So if you're interested in it, AV Studio Games Luda Booster will have a brand new version out ready for you to enjoy Australia or China. And that's it. So we're going to continue through February. Hopefully we'll get a start on March next week. Got some stuff already planned for that. It is a busy season. All kinds of crazy. I hope you guys like, comment, subscribe, because that's the way you can help me the most. If you don't know what to say, just tell me what you found interesting. And if you're going to pick up any of these games, or if you're looking for any type of particular content, that's always helpful. And a lot of the people end up subscribing are the people that make the games, and they might see what you have to say, you know, and interest them otherwise. They're like, oh, I want to jump on and have a different city, or I want a different theme, but I want this type of same type of game. And that could be all helpful info. Otherwise, hope you guys have a good one.